Good afternoon again. My name is Mr. Deitch. I'm the Social Studies Department Chair here at Waubonsie Valley. Today, as you're aware, is the 13th anniversary of the 9/11 terrorist attacks at the World Trade Center in New York City, as well as the Pentagon in Washington, D.C. And we have the great privilege to hear from a survivor of those attacks, Mr. Joseph Dittmar, who was in the second tower in New York City on that morning in 2001. In just about a minute, he's going to tell his story. And like all stories and oral history and primary source narratives, it gives us an opportunity to explore the human dimension of our history, what people felt and what people thought. You know, since the dawn of history, we've learned about the past through spoken word. And so today, as you listen to his words and his story, I want you to not only reflect upon his firsthand accounts of 9/11, but also the record of history that he is sharing with you today and passing on to you. Students and staff, please welcome Mr. Joseph Dittmar.
Wow. You know, I have to tell you, those of you that, well, yeah, I guess the question is, how many of you were here 13 years ago? Not many, right? Okay. I did my very first presentation at this school 12 years ago in your gym in front of 3,500 kids on a Friday afternoon, and the only thing standing between the weekend and them was me. And it was the most scary thing I had ever done in my life. But you know what? A lot has changed since then. Now we have Niqua and Mattia. This is the real valley. Is that right? Is that right? That's right. Okay. That's right. You all chose to be here today, which is kind of a cool thing. You weren't told you had to be here. You chose to be here. That's kind of a neat thing. It's a conscious decision that you make. One of many that you make every day in order to move ahead in your education and in your life. Our life is full of decisions, some big, small, some instant, some well thought out. Decisions are critical. And your ability to make these decisions is central in your performance. The information that you bring to a decision-making process affects the process in ways way more important than you might have ever thought. It's what you know, who you know, and how confident you are in those sources that make the decision possible for right or for wrong. And sometimes when you're in a decision-making situation, you're thrust into the role of leader and you're not even really sure how you got there. But in the end, you're forced to make a decision that can have a dramatic effect, not just on you, but on many others. And when you're at that point as a leader, it's one thing to have resource, data, information, background, but sometimes there is no resource, there is no info, and you need to make decisions with your gut feel because you are completely clueless. You can't go with the flow because there is no flow to go with. So you're sitting here saying, hey, this is the 9/11 guy. What's, you know, why am I here? What makes him some kind of expert at decision making? Is it the fact that I've become a fairly successful insurance guy for a billion-dollar corporation making million-dollar decisions daily? Or does it lie in the wisdom I'm asking my best friend in the entire world to marry me 36 years ago? Or was it the ability to raise four kids, three of who graduated from the Valley, okay, and guide them all to receiving full academic scholarships to college? Well, these things are proof of something, but perhaps not decision-making. I think my decision-making expertise was tried, tested, and galvanized on September 11, 2001. You see, as was mentioned, I was on the 105th floor of two World Trade Center, the South Tower, when the events of that day began to unfold. And my ability to be here today to relate all this to you is testament to making solid decisions. So let me share my story so that you see how the decisions of many affected that day. Man, I was looking at this picture when I came in, and if you take a look at the picture all the way up in the upper right-hand corner, the building to the right is One World Trade Center. The building to the left is the building that I was in, Two World Trade Center. The big billow of smoke over top of the black building that you see in the foreground, that's right where the plane was going in. That was the 78th floor. I was on 75. And when I see that picture, and when you see that picture, it's incredible for me to think that I am still here. But I am still here. And it's a blessing, truly a blessing. I'm in the insurance industry, as I mentioned. It wasn't unusual to be asked to go to the World Trade Centers and do a meeting at the World Trade Centers because they were like a mecca for the insurance industry. Virtually every insurance organization throughout the country, maybe throughout the world, had offices there. So in August of 2001, Mary Wieman, an extremely powerful woman at the Aon Corporation, she was born and raised in Arlington Heights, and Mary had smashed through the glass ceilings in the insurance industry that existed for women, and to a degree even still do to this day. And she had smashed through all that. She'd become this powerful leader. She called me, and she asked me to attend a meeting in New York at the trades the following month, and I didn't want to go to her meeting. I had the opportunity to go to the type of insurance meeting that involves aluminum or titanium sticks, little metal heads, little white balls in the grass, and you go like this, okay? I had a golf event that I could attend at the same particular point in time. That's what I wanted to do. But Mary did to me, on that phone call, what every woman has been doing to me since the day I was born. She threw good old-fashioned Catholic guilt down on my head. She said, sure, Joe, no problem. I understand. Nobody from CNA will be there. I'm sure your boss won't care. I'm sure the fact that your company's not going to be represented won't be a big deal. And I said, Mary, stop. Stop. I get it. I'll be there. I plan my work. I work my plan. And I did exactly that. I had the opportunity to go to New York, go to that meeting, but also had the opportunity to go to the other fun meeting that I wanted to do. So on the Friday before the Tuesday, I went back to Philadelphia, the city that I was born and raised in, the city that my mom and dad still lived in at that time. And I visited my mom and dad, and on Saturday I had the chance to visit my sister, and on Sunday I went to the Philadelphia Eagles-St. Louis Rams football game. You know, that's funny, my son is now 33 years old. I still pay for those season tickets, and he still sits in the seats in Philadelphia. It's a great deal for him. So for all you parents that are here, the bank of dad never closes, just in case you wanted to know, okay? But it was kind of funny because my son, he's a little shorter than me, but he's in great physical shape. He works for Valero Oil. He works on the pipelines in the Deepport in South Jersey. So he's like a roughneck. He's the guy that when there's an emergency, a fire, an explosion or whatnot, he's one of the guys that goes out to help repair that. Now the problem with that is he thinks he's macho as a result of all this. He thinks he's really tough, even though he is only 5'7", okay? And so it was kind of unusual. When we came out of that game that day, that Sunday, we're walking across the parking lot. He gives me this big, giant hug. And he whispers in my ear, I miss you, Dad. And I push back, and I see a little tear in his eye. And I knew he wasn't crying because of the game. The Eagles beat the Rams. Everybody beats the Rams, okay? I guess it was a pretense of what was about to occur, and we just didn't know it. He left his way. I went my way, did that meeting in South Jersey at a beautiful Marriott resort on Monday, and I had a plan that I had to stick to. If you've ever been to New York, if you've ever visited, if you come from New York, if you know people there, if you have family, the one thing you know about New York is that you don't want to drive into New York if you don't have to. The traffic is just brutal, okay? So here I was in South Jersey. I need to be in New York the next morning. I had a plan. I drove back from New Jersey to Philadelphia and got the Amtrak train, the Metroliner, from Philly to New York City. That was my plan. 3:30 in the morning, woke up in South Jersey, drove back to Philadelphia, got there at 5:30. Train pulls in at 6 a.m. I run down the steps with my round trip ticket now in my pocket, take off my suit coat, take off my backpack. I don't carry a briefcase, I carry a backpack. Took out my laptop, turned it on, sat down and did what all of us insurance executives do at 6 a.m. in the morning on the Metroliner train going to New York. I fell asleep. It was 6 a.m. I was tired. And off we went on the trip. And we were about two-thirds of the way up on that trip when my cell phone rang. Wow. You know what? I'm looking at this audience. Almost none of you remember life before cell phones. These things have been a part of your lives since the day you were born. It's incredible, okay? But back in the day, and there are some of you here that remember back in the day when you were on a business trip like this, you couldn't do anything without a plan. You had to have an itinerary, a written itinerary. It told people where you would be, what hotel you would be at, what meetings you would be at, what phone numbers at all those places so that people could communicate with you, so that you could be in contact with each other. Now with cell phones, wherever you are, that's where you'll be. Just hit me up on the cell phone, man. If you need me, just call me. It's no big deal. We'd gotten to that point in 2001 already, and I'm on the train. Before this trip, I had said to my wife, you know, hon, I'm going back to New York for a meeting on Tuesday, but I'm going to go back to Philly on the weekend, see my folks, go to the game with Joe, have the meeting on Tuesday, be back Tuesday night. Love you. That's basically all I told her. So now, I'm on the train, the phone rings, I answer, hello, I was asleep. And my wife says, I'm really sorry, I didn't mean to wake you up. I said, that's all right, it's all right. We're pulling into Newark and I gotta get off. She looked at me, she said, Newark, I thought you said you were going to New York. I said, yeah, but it's easier to get to the World Trade Center if you take the PATH train from Newark because it stops right underneath the World Trade Center complex. So that morning I told my wife exactly where I was going to be. And I dutifully got off that train with thousands of other New Jerseyans and made my way into New York City. And when we got to the Trade Center complex, it was pretty amazing. The security people in those buildings were incredible. There were as many as 25,000 people in each building at any particular point in time. Both buildings had their own zip code. They were little cities within a city. That's how big this complex was. But the security guys were incredible. And the 1993 bombing at the World Trade Center made that a reality. They seemed to know who did and who didn't belong just by looking at you. And they looked at me. They knew I wasn't a person that should be there, waved me over to the security desk. I ID'd myself. They took my picture. They put it on an ID card. And on that card, not only was the picture, but there was my name, the company that I was visiting, Aon, the floor that I was visiting, 105, how long the card was good for. It was good until September 12, 2001, and a barcode. And the barcode was the most important thing on that card because that barcode was not only containing all that information I just mentioned, but it was the way that you electronically swiped your way through the electronic turnstiles that separated you from the elevators. There were two banks of elevators, a bank of elevators to the right that serviced the first through the 77th floors, another bank of elevators to the left that went on an express basis from that lobby to the 78th floor. Each building had the same identical thing. The 78th floor was known as the sky lobby level, a second lobby in the building. It's exactly what it was. So we were going up to 105, which, by the way, was the highest occupied level of the building at that particular point in time. Both buildings were 110 stories high. The 110th story in the North Tower was the Windows of the World restaurant. Unfortunately, that was open that morning. The 110th and the 106th floors in the South Tower, the building that we were in, they were observation decks, and thank goodness it was too early in the morning for them to be open. The other floors that I did not mention over 105, they were occupied by heating, ventilation, air conditioning, elevator equipment, elevator cables, no people. Off we went to 105, the highest occupied level of the building in the South Tower. And when we got off the elevator at 78, made our switch over, got off at 105, there was Mary Wieman, the woman that I have mentioned before. And it was kind of surreal, because here's Mary, this extremely powerful insurance exec, right? And in one hand, she's got a spray bottle of Murphy's Oil soap, and in the other hand, she's got a rag. She wasn't Susie Homemaker by any stretch of the imagination, but this was how important this meeting was to her. She wanted everything perfect, right down to the furniture inside the internal conference room in which we were going to have our meeting. And she escorted us there. It was an internal conference room, as I suggested, like this auditorium that we're in, four walls, no windows, about a tenth of the size of this auditorium, and one set of doors. The meeting was supposed to commence at 8:30. No insurance meeting ever starts on time, and this day was no different. And at 8:48, the lights flickered. That's it. We didn't see anything. We didn't feel anything. We didn't hear anything. Just a flicker of lights. Almost immediately, a guy by the name of Rick Blood from the Aon Corporation came into the room and said, hey, there's been an explosion in the North Tower. We got to evacuate. And there's 54 intelligent human beings in that room, and we all did the same thing. We're fine. We're fine. It's New York. Stuff happens. Let us have our meeting. And Rick said, no, you don't understand. I'm a volunteer fire marshal for 105, 104, 103. I can't leave until all of you leave. And I want to leave. And I know he got everybody out of the room that day because I was the last guy out. He escorted us all to the nearest fire stairwell on 105 and told us that we were now going to walk down 105 flights of steps. Oh, yeah. What a bunch of happy campers at that particular moment. Everybody pulled out their phone. We're going to call and moan and groan about the fact that we couldn't have our meeting. And something really interesting happened at that moment. This was back in the day of flip phones. If you still have one, shame on you, okay? But this was back in the day of flip phones, and everybody flipped them up, okay? Going to turn them on, and no signal, no service, no signal, no service. You see, the main cell tower for all of southern Manhattan was on top of the North Tower, the first building that had been hit. Cell service virtually interrupted. And if you think, okay, get on a regular phone, a landline is what that's called for you young folks, okay? But get on a landline, get on a regular phone, call, good idea, except everybody that's in New York is now trying to call their mom, dad, sister, brother, aunt, uncle, whomever, on those landlines to let them know that they're okay. And even more incredibly, but very believably, everybody in the world, that's no stretch, everybody in the world that knows somebody in New York is now trying to call in on those landlines to make sure mom, dad, sister, brother, aunt, uncle are okay. Landlines were overmatched, couldn't handle the traffic. Cell service virtually interrupted. Lines of communication were gone. So, we're all standing there and we're all doubly perturbed now and doubly upset about the fact that we can't communicate. And I'm sure some of you are thinking to yourself, well, my God, didn't you understand what was going on? And that's exactly the point. Every mother and father of you, every one of you who are old enough to recognize and realize knew way more at that particular time what was going on inside and outside those buildings than any of us that were right there. We had no clue. Not a clue. We began our way down. We got down to the 90th floor. All the doors and the fire stairwells had been closed, except at the 90th floor it was propped open. I'm in the fire insurance business. How ironic is that, okay? And I know that when you get in a fire stairwell, you don't leave it. You only leave it at the lobby level. I know that. But there, the door propped open at the 90th floor. I don't know the building. I'm thinking maybe I need to go to another fire stairwell because everybody's filing out. And I went with them. And that's where I experienced the worst 30, 40 seconds of my life. To see that North Tower, unbelievable, huge black holes through the sides of the building, gray and black billows of smoke, pouring out of those holes, flames redder than any red I had ever seen before in all my life, licking up the sides of the building and beyond the roof level. And it was a crystal clear September day that day. And I remember being able to see through that smoke, through that fire, into those huge holes and see the fuselage of a large plane lodged inside the building. And I kept thinking, my God, how did the pilot miss the building? And the fact was that he didn't miss. He didn't miss. And to see all that, to see furniture, paper, people being pulled out of the building against their will, was an incredible, awesome, gruesome sight. I knew, I'm looking at this and I said, okay, this isn't a made-for-TV movie. This isn't an Xbox game. This is reality. And I was so afraid. I just wanted to go home. I had that pit in my stomach. I want my mommy feeling. I just wanted to go home. I didn't want to be there. I turned around immediately. People were frozen on that floor, whether they were frozen in fear, mesmerized by what they saw. They're screaming at the top of their lungs, but they can't seem to move. I turned to go. Behind me is Lud Picaro from the Zurich Insurance Company, huge guy. He was an All-American middle linebacker at University of Pittsburgh at one point. And I almost knock him down with my little body. And he puts his big paws on my shoulder. He says, what are you going to do? I said, I'm getting out of here. What are you going to do? And he said, you know what? I think that's a good idea. But before I go, I'm going to go to the restroom. That simple decision to use the men's room cost Lud his life that day. That delay in his trip cost him his life. They made an announcement on the PA system at that time. The event has been contained to the North Tower. The South Tower is considered safe. We suggest that if you work in the South Tower, you return to your workstation. If you are a visitor, we suggest that you stay where you are until further notice. And if you feel you need to proceed, please proceed with caution. I was getting out. I didn't know how cautious I was going to be. The announcement, when you think about it, was logical. There's a woman or man in charge of building security in that building at this particular point in time. 25,000 people maybe in the building. There's got to be a cop on one side, a firefighter on the other side, looking at this person saying, where are you going to put these people? Outside of training concrete, steel, bodies, where are you going to put them? And this person must have thought to themselves, the elevators are going up and down, the electricity's on, the ventilation system's working. Everybody stay put. Everybody stay put. Let's figure out what's going on. Who would have thought that within 18 minutes, the same exact thing would happen again? Who would have thought? I got down to the 78th floor sky lobby level. Mary Weeman, the woman I've mentioned several times, screaming at me to go to the elevator with her. Very powerful, very strong leader. I see a couple of guys that were in my meeting going to the elevator with her. My common sense said, you know what? Building, state address, yeah, I know it's not my building, but I don't think I should get in an elevator. And I looked at Mary, kind of gave her a wave, and turned and went back down to the fire stairwell. Arguably the best decision I've made in what is still my life, because I was somewhere between the 75th and the 72nd floor when the second plane plowed through our building. That plane went through our building on an angle between 78 and 82. We were only a few floors below the strike zone. I've never felt anything like that in my life. That fire stairwell that we were inside shook so violently from side to side, shaking at angles that I'm not an engineer, I can't tell you, but shaking like it shouldn't shake. Concrete spidering out, handrails breaking away from the wall, the fire retardant material coming down on us like snow. We feel this heat ball blowing by us. We smell this jet fuel, and the steps are literally undulating underneath our feet like waves in the ocean, and we're rocking back and forth and back and forth. And it felt like forever. And maybe it was seconds, maybe a minute. And you would have thought that there would be this craziness, this pandemonium. And yet there was nothing in that stairwell after it all stopped and came to and settled. Then a stunned silence. Just a stunned silence. We got through. We're making our way down. And we saw something at that particular time that you don't see enough of in life today. And that is human nature at its finest. Almost immediately, people who were in need were getting help from people just like you and me. People that were on crutches, on canes, in chairs, just worried, just sick, just not understanding what was going on, just afraid, they were getting help. They became teammates with people just like you, me, and we coached and coaxed each other down the steps and made our way. And everybody was heading in the same direction. We're all going down. Plenty of room, 3-4 people wide, and everything's pretty copacetic until the 35th floor. And that's the chance we had for the first time to encounter the police, the firefighters and the paramedics from New York City and the Port Authority. Just the looks in their eyes told the story. Just the looks in their eyes. They knew. They knew. They knew that they were going up those steps to try to fight a fire that they couldn't beat. They knew that they were going up those steps to try to save lives that they couldn't save. They knew that they were marching into the bowels of hell, and they knew that they were going up, and they knew that they were never coming back. They knew. They knew. I ask you, could you be that brave? Could you be that strong? Almost immediately, at that same time, there was a guy walking along with us. He was a maintenance guy from the building. He had a Nextel phone with the walkie-talkie feature. And this thing had been amazingly quiet the entire trip. And when we saw the cops and the firefighters and paramedics, this thing started to belch and beep, make all kinds of electronic noise. We hear this voice scream out, "We're on 82! We can't get down! We don't know what we're going to do!" And this guy, he's right to my left, stops, dead in his tracks, and goes to spin and turn back up. And I said, "What are you going to do, man?" And he looked at me and he said, "You know, I don't know, but I got to save my friend." I submit to you, that nameless maintenance man, that is a true American hero. That man who is willing to lay down his life to save that of a friend. I can only hope that the cops and the firefighters turned him around and made him leave that day. When we got down to the lobby level, we were able to see what looked like the vestiges of war outside, twisted steel, crumbled concrete, and red blotches on the ground. And we couldn't get out at the street level because of all this. So they take us down into the concourse, underground, the underground level of the buildings. This was this huge concourse. It was like a mall, every store known to mankind down there. Big train station, the PATH train station, signs that mean absolutely nothing to you if you're not from New York, and corridors going every which way. It was a rat maze. And when we got down there, we saw people in need, people with missing limbs, gaping wounds, true blood and guts stuff. And you wanted to reach out and help, but you couldn't because there were so many firefighters, cops, paramedics there to help. I've never seen such an outpouring of caring, of concern, of love, and that's what that was that day, this total outpouring of love. So those that needed help were getting help that they needed, and those of us that were okay, we were on our own. And the herd mentality takes over. And you hope that somebody knows what's going on at the front of your herd. Now, hear this guy say, "We want to get to the northeastern end of the complex. It's the furthest away from the buildings." My little internal GPS said, "You know what? That makes sense. I'm following him." And we're making our way through those corridors, and we're getting ready to make our last left toward the northeastern end of the whole complex. And there it is, ladies and gentlemen. Starbucks. And it is open. And there are people in line. I kid you not, okay? I am a card-carrying member of the Starbucks Nation, okay? But I don't know how much double, triple crappuccino one has to drink. I mean, you know, it's incredible, but it shows you that not even in the best of circumstances or the worst of circumstances, the best minds are where they need to be. We were fortunate. We were able to get out of the complex, get up to the ground. I mean, they're bulldozing back with those baby bulldozers of bobcats. Everything, I mean everything. And they're screaming at us, "Run, run, run, don't stop, don't stop." And you can't help it. You get across the street, you look back, and you see this ticker tape of concrete, steel, and bodies. I had a friend of mine that I'd met on the way down. We were going to go to his house on the Upper West Side. I was supposed to go back on the train to Philadelphia, get in a rental car, drive to the airport in Philly, fly back to O'Hare. That was what I was going to be doing. That didn't look like it was going to happen. And Duffy and I, we got into someone's flat apartment in southern Manhattan. And we holed up and we did what everybody else in the world did at that point in time, watch TV, to try to make some sense about what was going on. At about the fifth hour into the event, after trying to communicate with anybody that I could, I got my mom. I got my mom. And calling your mom is like calling CNN, right? I mean, you know, it's incredible. My mom called everybody. She called the cousins that I don't even talk to anymore, okay? But that's how important this was. And we started to get our words out. Right at that time, one of the true heroes of that day, the mayor of New York, Rudy Giuliani, got on the TV. People, every form of transportation had been shut down immediately. Immediately. We didn't know what was coming next, so we shut it all down. And everybody in New York, everybody in Chicago, was walking out of the loop, walking out of Midtown Manhattan, walking to get home, as far away as Aurora, right? As far away as Long Island for the New Yorkers. Giuliani knew that people just wanted to get home. They just wanted to get home. And he believed that he had mustered enough confidence in the uniforms that he had around him, and he was going to reopen the subways. Reopen the subways! My friend Duffy said, come on, we're going to my place. We got down to the subway station, the second train pulled in, we got on. We went two stops up. Penn Station, Amtrak. The way I had come in that morning. And Duffy looked at me and I looked at him. And we didn't say a word. He knew I wanted to get out. Even if I couldn't get back to Illinois, maybe I could get back to Philly, where my parents were. And I got into the train station with him. We looked like two tourists. There's a woman from Amtrak. And in her finest New York, she said, so where are you going, honey? And I said, I need to get to Philadelphia. And she said, there's a train down here about to take off. And I reached into my pocket, I had to return ticket. And she looked at me and she said, are you kidding me? We're not collecting tickets today, sweetie. I mean, some things never change in New York, okay? And we got on that train and you go underneath the Hudson River and you come up on the Jersey side and you look back at what was once the greatest skyline in all the world, now relegated to a gray and black cloud. How sad. And you're in a train packed with people sitting and standing for 80 minutes. There were no words spoken. There were no words to say. I got to Philly, got in my rental car, drove up to the house that I grew up in as a kid, where my mom and dad lived, and my mom was there to greet me. I got to tell you people, especially you guys, love your mothers. Love your mothers. I'm 45 years old at that point. And there's my mom. And she comes, and she gives me this big, giant bear hug. Pats my bald head, sobs, my baby, my baby, my baby. My mom did for me at that moment what my mom continues to do for me to this day. She helped me, and she loved me. And that's what I needed at that moment, was my mother's love. I slept at that house that night. Woke up early the next morning, called the office back here in Chicago, let them know that I wasn't going to be in. And it was a good thing, because they thought I was dead. And I started to make the long drive in that rental car back to Aurora, Illinois, right off of Viola Road. And I must have called my wife for about 100 times on that way. And that was before rollover minutes and national plans. I didn't care. I was reaching out and touching anybody. I wanted to be heard. They wanted to hear me, okay? And it was a good thing to be able to do that. And when I got her for about the 100th time, I said, hon, I'm almost there, 10, 15 minutes away. And she said, okay. And I said, there was a hesitancy. You got someplace better to go? And she said, well, actually, they're having a mass, a special mass at Our Lady of Mercy. And I said, you know what? It's a good day to go to church. I'll be there. I'll be there. I pulled down the Yellow Road, tried to get into the parking lot. It was like Christmas. There was no room at the inn. And I don't know whether I was more afraid the day before or the minute I opened up the back door to that church to see those hundreds of pairs of eyes all staring back at me, knowing where I had been. And I looked over to the right, to the pew where we always sit. We're Roman Catholics. We always sit in the same pew, okay? And there... there is my wife, a couple of my kids, and my friends. And my wife, she loves to talk, but she's not a demonstrative person. She can never be up here making a fool out of herself like I do. And I see her jump over the back of the pew and run to the back of that church and give me the greatest hug and a kiss that a man could ever want. And I knew at that moment that I was home. I was home. And so that is how this story goes. There are so many concepts and lessons learned in this story that it's almost impossible to recap them all. But when it comes to decisions and decision-making processes, the key lessons are pretty clear. Every decision is important, no matter how big or no matter how small one may seem. A decision can change your life and the lives of others way more than what you ever could have imagined. The information, the resource, the trust that you have in your source that you bring to a decision-making process determines the strength and accuracy of that decision for better or for worse. And the most important lesson, making the right decisions is not easy. It is not easy. But if you trust your heart, if you trust your source, if you trust your mind, if you trust your soul, if you trust your gut, you can make a critical decision that can have tremendously successful results. Now, I'm here today alive and fortunate to be able to share all this with you 13 years later because of a series of critical decisions made in the most critical of situations. However, you don't need to be in a flaming high-rise building on the 105th floor during a terrorist attack to be that effective and successful. You can be in a beautiful auditorium in a great high school in Aurora, Illinois. And by making the right decisions, you can have positive and lasting effects on your peers and your partners, helping them and helping you to improve and save the lives of others. You know, I don't do this to feel better. God knows it only breaks my heart again and again. And I don't do it for fame or notoriety, nor do I do it for monetary gain. I don't accept payments for my presentations. I do this because I believe as a person who has been a part of a historic event, it is my obligation, it is my duty to tell the story and to give a voice to the 3,000 who lost their own voices that day so that they once more can be heard and to allow their spirits so senselessly dashed that day to rise once again and to let them know that while they may have been lost, their lives were not lost in vain. And while I seek no payment, I do ask each and every one of you to pay back in one way and in one way only, to always remember and to never, ever, ever forget. God bless the valley. God bless Illinois, and God bless America. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you.
On behalf of Waubonsie Valley High School's administration, students, faculty, staff, as well as the district office, we are so glad and we're so proud to have you here. We do not find your presentation in any way foolish, but are indeed blessed that your decisions will allow us never to forget. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Thank you.